All right, this is great. Do I have the room? I have a little bit of room here, and we can do a little bit of taping here. Welcome back to the studio here. Just came back from a 5-hour excursion doing a tremendous amount of very intense, fun taping. And just before I started taping here, this huge white plane flew directly overhead at low. I haven't seen anything like that before. This is a very good sign. It was a white plane flying directly overhead. You have to say, ah, that's very positive. Super positive. So everything is going great. I hope it's going, your life is blessed as mine is actually, which is getting very blessed indeed. Keep in mind that salvation is not our job. Our job is just we play our role in salvation. We have a role to play. Salvation is salvation of everyone, all of us. It's neither one of us, it's all of us. And so, who's in charge of salvation, really? Well, the Holy Spirit is. Okay, the Holy Spirit's in charge of salvation. And so, we have to listen to the Holy Spirit and do what the Holy Spirit tells us to do. Okay, and it's very unique for each one of us, actually. Holy Spirit says, go here, do this. It sent me to this place last week. It's been actually a week ago that I was sent to this place and did this taping. And it was just and now the videos are coming out, and it's just, it's gorgeous. It's just so beautiful. It's just amazing. It's just I'm blow it blows my mind. I just say, wow. I took this. I was there. I did this. It's the Holy Spirit that's doing it. And the Holy Spirit, as we say, it works through aspects of grace. You could call them Jesus, Christ Jesus. You can call it Manjushri, right? You can call it Longchenpa, Padmasambhava, Anandamayi Maharshi, Jemmy Kenshi Choki Lodro, and you can give it different terms. But all of that, they have roles to play too in salvation. It's the salvation of the entire sonship. That's salvation. Okay, it's not just a few are saved and others are not. No, it's the entire sonship, and the Holy Spirit is the way. It knows the way. It's already done it. It just has to get our acceptance of the fact it's already done this. So what the Holy Spirit is working towards is not so much salvation, but acceptance that it's already happened. It's already done. It's already done. Okay, so we have the capacity to deny this, right? And say, no, I don't think it's done. No. So it's acceptance. Acceptance. Allow and wow is the way. Allow and wow. Allow your acceptance to arise and then wow it. Allow your acceptance to arise and then wow it. So, 5-hour excursion today. I've done, this is the fifth taping I've done today. Different tapings. The fifth one. That's just amazing. It requires tremendous fitness, actually. And I really am going to feel it tomorrow. But that's okay. I feel it every day. I'm getting pounded all this, but the body, is standing up to it. But I got to really keep the body going in good shape here to just handle the intensity of what the Holy Spirit wants me to do. The Holy Spirit asked, I told me 14 months ago, a little over 14 months ago, that they say. The Holy Spirit indicated, hey, there's something that you could do if you want to do it. That would be very helpful. It's up to you. You don't have to do it. If you don't do it, that's fine. We'll work at it some other way. But there's something that could really, you'd really enjoy it, really love it. And it's right perfect for you. So would you like to do it? And I said, well, yeah, but what do I have to do? Well, you have to get in shape. That's the kicker. I said, uh-oh. Because I was totally out of shape 14 months ago. Absolutely decided that there's no hope for the world. And there still isn't any hope for the world. But there's hope for the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has already saved us all. So there's hope for acceptance that this is true. The world represents our refusal to accept that we've already been saved. And it's a very intense time right now where everybody, so many in the world, are so intent on refusing this fact. So intent. And they're getting very belligerent about it. They're very angry. They say, "No, don't you dare tell me I'm already saved. No, I'm still damned, you know. No one's damned. Nobody. Not one of us is damned at all. We're already totally saved, all of us. We just have to accept it. We can, again, deny this and then keep playing out this pretense that it's not true, which is the world. And so it's getting very belligerent, and so I'm doing what I love doing, and I have to be more careful, actually. You don't want negativity right now, because each one of us needs to be in the super positive mode. Okay, super positive mode. Doing what we love to do. Doing what we love to do. And so I'm doing what I love to do. Maybe there'll be something even better come along. Probably better and better and better and better and better. This is keeping me occupied, all this taping. And the results are just better than I could have imagined, actually. I mean, I get the benefit of taping all this and then, you know, uploading it. And then correcting, color correcting, and changing the speeds if I need to, and trimming and doing all the editing, and then putting together a video, editing together a video, and then watching the video and proofreading the video, make sure there's not too many mistakes. I mean, if there's some mistakes, I say, that's okay, it doesn't matter. I'm not trying to be perfect here. I've got to do things fast. And then watching it to make sure the music is okay, putting the music on. So I'm immersed in these videos, producing them as the producer. So I get to see him over and over and over and over. And the more I see him, the more I appreciate him. I just say, wow, this is just amazing, Holy Spirit, what you're doing. It's just amazing to me. I used to have a little point-and-shoot Nikon Coolpix. It's like $140 or something. That actually, some it's not even mine. Someone lent it to me. And then I got the GoPro, which is really a specialty, special effects kind of camera. The Coolpix, the real cheap point and shoot, is actually, you know, that's for portraits and landscapes and all that. And the other is better for up close action sort of stuff. I haven't really used it that much, but the time lapse, it does time lapse, and I have to edit the time lapse because it's fisheyed, and so I have to like zoom into the time lapse to get rid of that fisheye effect, that bowl like effect. And then color correct it and everything. So it's a lot of work, actually. It's a lot of work using the GoPro. So I use it judiciously, but the use of it so far is great. I mean, I'm just thrilled by the videos. And again, you know, you can't force people to watch. So I just keep doing what I love to do, and I'm thrilled with it. And this has pretty much been my life, is that people are scared of the sublime. And so I'm saying, hey, the sublime is there, you know, embrace it, you can do it. And like I say, familiarity, continuity fear is the problem with us. And I've gone to some really beautiful places and told people about them, and they freeze up. You can tell they're scared. They look at me and I'm almost shining, and they're saying, oh, it's too much for me, I can't handle it. This is a fact. We can't handle success. We don't know how to handle success. And I said that, I've been saying this thousands of times, continuity fear is the only problem we have. It's we're afraid of success. All right. We're afraid that we've already been saved. Oh, I'm going to be catapulted back into reality. No. The Holy Spirit gently leads us back to awareness, acceptance of reality. Gently, gently, beautifully, lovingly, gently. We don't get catapulted back in it, no matter how much we try. Why do I keep tugging that? So there's no worries. I mean, so my life is gently, gently, gently gets better and better and better and better and better. You know, what's next? Well, the Holy Spirit said, you're just getting started here. I said, wow, because it's just amazing. I had so much fun today. It was just extraordinary. I just had a blast. It was just beautiful. So I end up in really beautiful places, doing really beautiful things, very creative. And I get more and more and more feeling, you know, just used to it, comfort zone with it. There's a saying, you can take someone out of the ghetto, but you can't take the ghetto out of the sub one. You're used to your environment, your circumstances, and all that. And good fortune comes, and we tend to shrink from it. We really do. So we have to be conscious of this fact. This is the key. Don't worry about the negativity. You're already saved. Everyone is. So the problem is not we need to be saved. It's that we need to accept that we've already been saved. Okay, so this is a really different way of looking at it. But this is what Jesus tells us. I trust in Jesus, so I believe this is so. There's no reason at all to say it's not so. The Holy Spirit has proven to me that it most certainly has the capacity to do this. And therefore, it must be done. It's not going to have a capacity and not use it. So the capacity, we're already saved. You're saved, I'm saved, everyone is already saved. And we have to let this sink in. Have to let it sink more and more and more. Allow and wow. Allow this recognition to arise and then wow it. Allow and wow. I broke a cardinal rule today. I got in the car, vehicle, and left too early from the taping. I got to take 10 minutes to calm down. I was so hyped up. And so I started making some mistakes, driving mistakes, little driving. I took a wrong turn, for instance. But it turned out to be a nice excursion. So that was okay. taping in San Francisco, it's really cool to do that. I've always been afraid of the city because the downtown area is just, it's hectic, it's intense. All the one-way streets, you know, you just have, you know, it feels like you're not in control of where you're going at all. You're just being pushed this way and that way. And but there are other areas that are, it's a very beautiful place, to say the least, San Francisco. And so, you know, spending a little time in San Francisco is just, you know, it's cool. It's very nice. I appreciate it. And so the Holy Spirit's getting it done in every which way. And it's tipping me off to other places, locations. And as it says, it's going to get better and better and better. And so, again, your task is the same as mine. Get used to the sublime. Put more and more. And I know, like, pictures are nice. Okay, we got a picture and a quote. Okay, that's a stage. That's good. All right, so if you're doing that, that's great. That's helpful, very helpful. I do that too. I enjoy that. There's other stages. Try to work into video. It's more living. It's more like an immersion. It's stuff is happening. The sublime is coming at you from more 360 degrees. So you have to start working on 360 degrees. Whereas if there's a linear picture, linear quote, it's kind of like, you know, it's a little less intense, but it's okay. It's helpful. So don't put yourself down. If that's what you're doing, that's great. As Rama said, Shravaka, the listening is the first stage. Listening to truth is the first step, a very essential step. Here, we're going further. We're using words, of course, because I've been trained how to use words properly. And so it doesn't cause a problem for me at all. And it's part of the 360 degree. When you realize we've already been saved, then it's okay. It's okay. But I'm, you know, we're doing other stuff also, some words, some interactions, some humor, a lot of action, a lot of beauty, a lot. So it's more intense, and I feel that most people are having trouble with this. But you gotta step up right now. You have to ask yourself, do I want to just keep on doing what I'm used to doing, or do I want to take this pivot? Do I want to pivot into 360? And so I'm helping you pivot into 360. And it's fine. It's no trouble at all. Certainly you will feel nervousness occasionally, but every day you should be going past the wall of your expectations. So that's just part of your spiritual practice, is going past these boundaries. So I, you know, pushed past some boundaries today. For instance, I got my shoes completely soaked. and it was great, because once I did, I said, oh, to heck with it. They're already soaked. So I just went out running in, you know, in the water, and I didn't worry about it anymore. They got more soaked and soaked. And I said, okay, I came up finally to a water fountain and just washed them off, all the sand off. And I came home and I completely rinsed them out. And now I know I could do that. But as before, I was very, very like nervous about, I can't get my shoes wet. And now I realize, hey, I can get my shoes wet. It's no problem. I get my pants wet, I get it, you know, whatever. It's okay. So this expands my repertoire. Because before, I'm worried about how, you know, I got to wear waterproof shoes. No, just let your shoes get wet. And I hadn't thought of that before. I said, no, I got to keep my shoes dry. I can't get your socks wet, you know. What do you mean I can't get my socks wet? I drove home fine with wet shoes, wet socks. So I can wear shorts and then I can go out, in, I can even actually get a spring suit or something with shoes and just wade out in the water, kind of deepish or something. That might be interesting to do that. Yeah. Who knows what I'll do? I'm open to, it just expands and expands and expands and expands. You get every day you get more confident. This is what your life should be like. You should do little things every day. In fact, I've been doing this since 1978. The Holy Spirit says, just do this little thing, little thing, little thing, little thing. And you just keep doing these little things like raindrops. And eventually you've got a mighty river with raindrops. Okay. This is how it goes. This is how it goes. You become more useful to the Holy Spirit. So we're already saved, and we each have a unique role in salvation. So just carry out your role. Carry out your role. And you have to be very careful not to ask negative people, "What do you think?" Because they throw water on the fire, you see. And if you wow your life, you won't need those people in your life. What I found is we hang out with, there's two types of people: those who are full of inspiration and those who throw water on inspiration. That they put the brakes, slam the brakes on it. And oftentimes relationships are like this. And this is what I've had in my life. I've discovered this is for sure. I'm so inspirational that I felt like I got scared. I couldn't function in this world. People might think I'm just too much. And so you hang around people who subvert you, your inspiration. They put the brakes on it. And so you feel like, oh, I can't do that, really do that. I don't feel good enough. And they slam the brakes on it, but that's because we're afraid that we might be too inspirational. But if we wow what we're doing and take the time to wow it, then we allow it. Okay? Allow and wow and allow. So it's a beautiful I am that I am. Allow and wow and allow. So it's a super positive spiral that happens in your life. And so I just, this trip was so intense. I haven't wowed it quite enough yet. 'Cause it was really so many people there. Everybody's looking at me, and I'm just taping right out in the open with people walking by, and I'm talking to the camera and doing stuff, but I just don't pay them attention. I just keep doing it because I'm into it. I got to get it done, and even somebody was going to go in front of the camera, and then they saw it and said, "Oh, okay, sorry," and they went around it and they said, "Well, at least I saw it," and I said, "Yeah, thanks." And so everybody's aware. If you're put out positive vibes that it's not too much for you, everybody's okay with it. But if you start struggling, they look at you struggling, all the brake people come in and slam on the brakes for you. Really, they do. And so you have to keep this project, this wow, be into it, be able to do it, and then wow it so you don't start asking for help, like, "Help, put the brakes on, help put on, I'm scared." This is very difficult to do. This is why very few are doing it. If you really look on Facebook, YouTube, social media, the world, very few are doing what I'm doing here. It's almost non-existent. I'm just doing it by myself because nobody else, they're scared to do it. They won't do it. And most people won't go to beautiful locations. They're too scared. They say, I don't deserve this. I don't belong here." And I was at many beautiful locations today. Just so I was like, wow. Wow. And letting that wow sink in. And so we sabotage ourselves if we're scared. We sabotage ourselves. Like I said, if we're going to a really beautiful place, we'll get sick and say, "Oh, I can't go. I'd really like to go, but I can't. I got sick." It's all self-sabotage. All suffering is self-sabotage, actually. All of it. We all choose to bring it upon ourselves. Why? We're afraid of reality. So it's so sublime that, we are life. And life is wherever we want it to be, actually. So there's no such thing as set life, like structure. Light, we cast, we could just have life just flow out from us everywhere. Infinite life. Okay. Just right now, we can do this. We are the source of life because we are one with God. We're the Son of God, which is the source of all life. And we're an extension of the source of all life. And so we can have just life, infinite life, eternal life, just flow out from us Where life is wherever we want it to be, actually. Wherever we want it to be. And I saw this yesterday working, last night working on editing this video, which the video, Life is Wherever We Want It to Be. And I suddenly, the ocean was coming in, these beautiful, at low tide, these beautiful, soft kind of flows of water, bubbly flows, so beautiful. And I suddenly realized, I saw the ocean, I suddenly saw it completely full of life. And I realized this is my own mind was just filling the entire ocean with life. Everywhere, it was completely overflowing with life. I said, I just did that. So I realized I'm the one who puts life everywhere. This meaning the spirit. My spirit is the living life, is the living light of life. We are the living light of life, all of us. So this is very, very sublime. And it so this is like practice. You have to take yourself seriously enough to practice. Those who aren't practicing don't take themselves seriously enough. They think, oh, I don't really deserve to succeed. They're afraid of success. That's it. Continuity fear has them really scared of success. So I said, someone else has to do it. I can't do it. It's too scary. They don't practice. So the spiritual path, really, you really feel it when you start practicing. And then you realize your success starts to arrive. And you say, wow, this is working. And then you have to manage your success, right? This is what I say to everyone. Manage your success on the path. I bought this brand new pair of headphones. I'm going to use it for the first time. There's a loud buzz. I can't get rid of it. Ridiculous, right? Ridiculous. So hopefully this one is working properly. You know, technology, a lot of the stuff's getting worse. It's not getting better. Cheaper and cheaper and cheaper junk. I remember the days when we get headphones, we got stuff, it lasted almost forever, you know, and it worked great. And the stuff you buy now, it doesn't even work at all. I can't even use it. This is progress. I don't know what kind of an odd definition of progress, isn't it? It kind of seems like a regression, actually, would be more accurate. So I have a weight I need to reach by the election. I don't know if I'm going to reach it because I had to eat something today. All that intense taping. You know, when inspiration hits, you just have to jump on it and just do it. You can't look around and say, well, are there people around? What will they think? How will it turn out? I don't know. That doesn't work. This is why you have these movie industry has these massive production companies. They have, you know, budgets of 20, 30 million to make a film and stuff. I have like a budget of zero. Okay. And I'm a one-man crew. That's it. And so it's just spontaneous. I just do it. But this requires tremendous nerve and capacity. And this is why others don't do it. They might rationalize, oh, I don't want to do it. No, that's continuity fear. It's continuity fear. We're not functioning optimally here in this world at all. I'm starting to function a little more optimally now. It's still, you know, very low, but most are almost at, you know, like one. On a scale of 1 to 100, they're at one. They're just robotically functioning, basically. And so you have to break out of this roboticism, this autopilot roboticism, in order to be creative like this. It's very difficult to be creative in this world. As the world becomes more and more robotic, you know, creativity is frowned upon. It you know, makes the robots feel inferior, and we can't have that. You know, we can't have the robots having an inferiority complex. They have a self-esteem problem, you know. These people have self-esteem problems, that's why, because they're robotic. And they say, my robot doesn't like me. Yeah. So all these therapy of the future is going to be like, you know, relationships problems with our robot. Yeah, I'm having relationship problems with my robot. My robot really doesn't seem to like me that much. It thinks I'm too intuitive or something. And so like, doc, you know, how can you help me? I got to get away from this intuitiveness. You know, I feel so guilty that I'm hurting the robot's feelings. And we laugh, but that's exactly what's coming. It's exactly what's coming. This is why we need to go to the Pure Lands here. There's no place for me here. You know, this what I'm doing now is just a fraction, a tiny, tiny glimpse of, you know, spirit. The spirit's completely spontaneous, no fear, utter spontaneity in the now. And I'm trying to bring some of that feeling to all of you as an example, as a role model of somebody who's really worked at this. The idea is you really work at something, then you need to be a role model to others, so you encourage them. You work at the level of motivation here. Motivation's all important. If there's no role models, guess what? We're not going to succeed. So these gurus have been very helpful role models for me, and they're tremendous spontaneity. But it's like too much, you know. They're it's just astonishing how fluid and capable they are. Nothing phases them here. So wonderful role models, and we'd like to have, you know, more role models of those. In the 60s, that was more of a youth thing, but there was a lot of role models, kind of role models, you know, that helped empower me. And my dad was a great role model. Okay, he was super intuitive, super spontaneous in the now. He was like an Olympic athlete and gymnast. I mean, he was super agile. You know, he could just flip up on one hand and walk on one, you know, jump, hop along on one hand on a handstand. I mean, he did one-handed handstands on rails over like Bridalveil Falls and stuff, you know, crazy stuff. You know, because he could, he loved it. So he was very, 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 very spontaneous in the now. And it was tough keeping up with him because you had to be really fit to do it. He was super fit. Just a tremendous walker and hiker, and he just had this awesome athleticism, and I didn't have that really. I mean, I was very coordinated, but I wasn't how I could say, like an acrobat. I wasn't acrobatic. So I've had to get myself in shape here, so I feel a little more core strength. I was young. I had great reflexes, super fast, and great coordination reflexes, but not. And I didn't have quite the core type of thing. And so this helps being spontaneous. It helps. It really helps. It's just like you have all-wheel drive, kind of. You know, all-wheel drive is a great to have. You feel, when you drive all-wheel drive, you feel like you've got this stability and traction, and you could just do it. So in the programs that we're producing here, part of this is to help you get all-wheel drive, and we call it Quest 360. We have this Quest 360 project here, and I want everyone to follow along. I mean, again, you have to make a decision now, which it's up to you. You know, I can't make decisions for you. Are you going to trust the fact that everyone's already been saved or not? This is all. If you trust that, you're going to repent and say, okay, let's get busy on accepting this. There's nothing else to do. Right? There's nothing else to do then. And so we just do it together. It's fine. The water's fine. I mean, the water wasn't that cold. I was thinking my feet would freeze. No, the water wasn't cold. It was no problem at all. But I had a blast just running from the waves. I mean, I had to be very nimble and quick and run backwards, sideways, at the same time taping, trying to keep a steady taping of everything that's going on. So it's requires just all this nimble awareness, which is great. 360 degree awareness. I'm working on it, and you know, work along with me on 360 degreeness. Quest 360. And we're just using the example of Tiger Ross to introduce this whole Quest 360 here. You don't want to be run down at this point or have a rundown attitude. So you can repent any moment. Just accept, trust it that everyone's already been saved. That's it. It's a fact. Everyone has already been saved. There's nobody that hasn't been saved already. Isn't that great? Isn't that wonderful? Doesn't that take a burden off of your mind if we really allow that to sink in? I saw this guy on a scooter. He had these huge wheels on it, man. He was just flying down this hill. I said, wow, maybe that's the way to go, actually. Skateboarding is too dangerous. But you don't flip off a scooter as much because you have the front handles to it. So maybe a scooter is coming at some point. I don't know. He was going down this steep, wow, I mean, Skateboarding would have been, it's too frightening to do that. I don't know. Maybe scooters are able to do stuff like that. I gave a thumbs up to him. He just saw me just kind of nodded, like, yeah, I get it. Yeah, why not give a thumbs up to somebody? You see somebody doing something like that? Thumbs up. Good for you, man. That's great. It was very, very nice. Then there are some other tourists. There's some totally bloated, fat, wealthy, materialistic young man, you know, with his smartphone. It was so gross. He was so gross. And the women with him were so gross. I mean, they were, you know, just some really wealthy, young, gross people. It's just like tech people. Wow. It's like, holy smokes. Good Lord. But they're safe too. It's just that they're, you know, fighting against, they're afraid of that realization that they're there for, so they want to, you know, hide in darkness, which is what the world is working on. How can we get a better hiding place here? It seems like God has found us out, you know, and so we gotta hide more. Oh, Ramaharshi found us out. It was terrible. And so they're trying to, you know, build a society where all of that is completely ignored, and then be revisionist, which is to say it never happened. It was just some crazy people hallucinated or something. You know, it never happened. That's the goal, is complete revisionism, to say that none of these gurus ever came in the world, that that they weren't really gurus, they were really social activists, and the crazy people believe in God completely misinterpreted what they had to say. And so now, and then they'll say, we're here to tell you what they really said, which is, you know, you're supposed to build a darker, darker, deeper hiding place from God so it can't never be found. And you know, they're trying to do that. Electronic age, the new electronic age is that. You say, oh no, God, we don't need you. We've found a wonderful hiding place here. And so amazing amount of revisionism is coming. I have no idea what an education would be if I was a child right now, but it would probably be absolutely horrible, right? It's just so amazing that we have the capacity to ignore the fact we've already been saved. We have that capacity to ignore it, okay? And we're doing that. It's called ignorance. Ignoring. The act of ignoring is ignorance. So we're willfully ignorant. No one's really ignorant, it's just willful ignorance. Drop the willful ignorance, and guess what? We're wise. We feel wise. It's right there. It's always there. This is just willful ignorance. It's not natural ignorance at all. It's continuity fear, willful ignorance. And so if we start lessening this, automatically we start to realize, hey, everyone's saved. I'm saved. We're all saved. And I can accept this now. Others, it's okay. Even if they don't accept it now, it's still a fact. It doesn't change the fact at all. So I guess I should be. No, I can't be uploading this because I'm taping to a memory chip right now. I don't know what I got. I don't. It's hard to see the viewfinder, and the GoPro has no viewfinder. But it doesn't matter. Whatever I got, it's going to be good enough, right? And because we're not worried about perfectionism, we're already saved. It is only necessary to take the edge off of our fear, and we start to lighten up and shine. Just take the edge off of our fear. That's it. We don't have to eradicate all the fear. Just take the edge off of it. That's why I say evaporate the continuity fear. And that takes the edge off of it. A little evaporation takes the edge off of it, doesn't it? It's all that's required. Just take the edge off of that fear. And then we begin to say, hey, wow. So allow, wow, and then allow, and then wow, and then allow, and wow, and just have your days like that. Allow and wow, and allow. Allow and wow, and allow. So I'm rolling out a lot of these new videos. Very wonderful, sublime stuff. Takes a lot of effort, a lot of editing. This is easy for me. I just sit in front of a camera. It's to the memory card. I upload to YouTube. It's there. That's it. Zero editing. So it's easy to get lazy this way. However, I understand that people are very busy. They want shorter videos. And so I want to compress everything into these shorter videos if I can. And I'll do some of these also. We'll have, you know, have it. We'll do it all. We'll do it all. But certainly, I invite everyone to also watch these shorter videos, and just realize, this is a reflection of allowing and wowing. reflection of allowing, allowing, and the trust that everyone's already saved. Okay, so I don't need to save the world. I don't need to save anyone. We're already saved. I'm just helping us get, you know, take the edge off our continuity fear and start to feel the sublime. And the amazing thing is I'm able to make it look better than it even looked when I was looking at it, although I was immersed in it, which is very intense. But the color correction and, you know, and various editing and contrast, brightness, contrast, color correction, and zooming in, and, you know, various things, it looks, you know, surreally sublime. I can hardly believe it. You know, those beach shots and stuff, it's just so beautiful. The color corrections and some stuff, you know, it's just, oh, man. So we can be helped by this, because beauty is actually wherever we want it to be. That's what we are, okay? Beautiful, beautiful, including ambience. Ambience is wherever we want it to be. It can be right here, right now. That's our power. We are the ones who can give ambience to everything, okay? So you don't have to be in Hawaii. You can give the ambience of Hawaii right here, right now, everywhere. This is a wonderful truth, and it's difficult for us. It's one of the things that we really struggle with. This, we think we need to go somewhere, and for a while still we will go some beautiful places and get that ambience, but we're working towards a real recognition that we give ambience to everything. So we can give this sublime ambience to ourselves right here, right now, wherever we are, and we'll be in this like bubble of paradise bubble, right? Paradise bubble. And everybody will feel that, wow, there's just, they seem to be in this wonderful ambience. And it's not coming from the world at all. So the big flipping of the script is nothing coming from the world. We are the world. We're the ones who are projecting the world. And we can project anything we want to project. If we want a gorgeously wonderful ambience, we can do this right here, right now. Don't need to be in California or Hawaii for that. Actually, at all. Not at all. And this is a huge leap in our recognition. And so you have to allow and wow this. And I'm doing this. Allow and wow. Don't try to rush it in terms of grabbing hold of it, analyzing. I got it. It arose. I saw it. I said, and then I wowed it. So you see this and then wow it. Don't try to grasp it or analyze it. Seeing it, you already know it's there. It's true. It's your acceptance that everyone's already been saved. Okay, so these breakthroughs will arise, and then you just wow it. Wow, this is great. Just, it's tremendous. And don't try to do anything with it. Don't try to explain it or do anything. Just wow it and let it sink in. Now, there are these dogs at the, you know, where it was, and there's huge mastiffs, you know, there's a whole bunch of them actually coming right towards me, and they're looking, what is that camera, what is that? They were kind of worried. I said, don't worry about it, just a camera. And I just walked past them, ignored them, and I put it on pause. I didn't tape the dogs. I don't tape dogs. I don't tape animals, okay? This is for those who are, you know, very afraid of the sublime, okay? They take refuge in their pets. But we can do better than that. We have to do better than that. Now, I don't intentionally, you know, that in that situation, there were people, a bunch of people. I don't want to be taping their dogs and them and everything. I try to make it clear I'm not trying to make anybody uncomfortable at all. So if somebody's walking along, I turn the camera away. I put on pause. Just let them know that I'm not trying to, you know, pull them into the sublime against their will. And so they just leave me alone. Everybody's fine. They smile at me, you know. They feel good about me. You know, there's a good feeling there because they realize, okay, he's not trying to force us. He's not trying to force us. But everyone has to realize that there's a very, very important decision, and you have to make the right one, and you got to go with repentance and realize everyone's already been saved. So there's that whole issue of, you know, what do I need to do to save people is off the table. It's gone. Nothing. But you can help us recognize that there's nothing we need to do, okay? Absolutely, we can help one another recognize there's nothing we need to do. Everyone's already saved. And so you might be like I'm doing all this very sublime stuff. You think, wow, what a blessed life. It is. It's a very blessed life right now I'm leading. And yet, you know, as far as worldly position, I'm at the bottom of the barrel. But no one would ever even imagine such a thing, because I'm leading a blessed life, because I'm willing to help the Holy Spirit out and help everyone out to, you know, evaporate our continuity fear here. So ask for 360 degree help. Just allow yourself to be flooded, immersed with help. And I will... I was trying to get these waterproof boots last night. I said, gotta get those. I decided no. The last second I said no. Why do I need waterproof boots? Why don't I just go barefoot? I could just go barefoot, right? I mean, I saw someone going barefoot. Why can't I just... Maybe I'll just go barefoot. Well... Because running barefoot on hard sand is really tough on your muscles. You're going to get shin splints by that. So I kind of like to have some cushioning with running shoes. But of course, if I was barefoot, I wouldn't need to run from the waves. I just let them wash over me. I could just be steady. So I might, in fact, I probably will try that out. We'll see. I never try to tie myself down. But that's actually a great thought. And a smooth, nice, smooth, clean beach, you know, why not go, just go barefoot? I hadn't thought of that, actually. I saw some guy going barefoot, and it just struck me, why don't I go barefoot? Roll up the pants and go barefoot. Yeah, I used to do that. Wow. So, you see how these little things just filter in, and you make improvements just because you notice that stuff. Everything's a play of grace, and, we can just notice what's happening around us, and then say, "Hey, I can do that. That helps me. That helps me. That helps me." So everything I notice helps me. It's like that. Yeah. Wow. The ocean's very sublime, isn't it? It really is. It seems boundless, and it seems to just pour all this abundance, overabundance, right? It's very humbling to be near the ocean. Very humbling indeed. That's why people like to walk along the ocean. It's very contemplative, very humbling. They're near something very great. It seems very great, doesn't it, the ocean? It's all one, right? It's all just this vast oneness of water. It's so vast, the ocean, the Pacific Ocean. It's so vast, it's incomprehensible how vast it is. And we're walking in the vastness of this one ocean. It's not separate from itself, is it? So as we're there at the edge of this vast ocean, we're there with the entire ocean. Water's like a gelatin, actually. If you take it real super slow motion, you realize it's a mass of gelatin, actually. We don't see it that way, but I've slowed it down, water, so much, and I see it, the way it moves, it's like jello, actually. It's very much like jello. But at regular speed, we don't see that. We don't see that. So it is like a huge vat of jello, a very viscous jello, the ocean, actually. And you know, you hit one area, and it pushes shock waves through the jello and produces all this undulation. Waves are just really the jello shaking, all the stuff, all sorts of chop in the ocean chop. It's just this whole vibration of this gelatin medium of what we call water. Now, yeah, water flows, but it's really a gelatinous medium. It really is. Liquids are that way. How amazing! It's great. Bowl of jello. Maybe that's why Jesus could walk on the water. He saw it the right way. He says, this is just this nice gelatin, no problem. So yeah, looking, it's at 44 right now. There you go, Jimmy. He said 44. I haven't looked at the time at all. I just said, well, I wonder. I just sort of looked at it. It's 44, and it's like 44, 44, right? Boom, now. Isn't that amazing? It's incredible. The 44 number is just coming up constantly. That 55, 45, 55 also comes up all the time. That's my number, 55. So I'm finding out that, yeah, when you're in the wow, don't solicit anyone's opinion of yourself, okay? So it's very important in the wow is you, it's just the wow and that's it. You're not in dialogue with anyone at that point. You're not asking anyone's opinion, positive or negative. You just have to stay away from any reaction at all except just the wow. You're only entertaining your own wow. Really important. You're in charge of your path. You're in charge of your wow. And the wow means hands off to everything. This is your quiet time. You have the right, you have to insist on it. You need some time during the day where there's no input from anyone, and you're just and I need to do that myself because the wow that I'm experiencing now is tremendously intense. I mean, I just go out in these completely public places. I mean, place today was a very dignified, super, super nice, incredibly beautiful place, and a lot of very wealthy, dignified people there. And I was just, you know, doing the taping and doing all this stuff just right out, you know, spontaneously. And I just have the ambience, you know, that I belong to, you know, and nobody raised an eyebrow. Nobody raised an eyebrow at me. Nobody. Because I look like I'm dignified, I'm nimble, I'm, you know, I'm shining in a certain way and confident, shining with confidence. And when you shine with confidence, people say, oh, okay, you know, that they're doing something right. So there's no, they're not, you know, bothering me. As long as they don't bother me, that's fine. That's fine. I'm not trying to tape other people. You know, that's where people get all jittery. I'm taping myself, and I can handle that. Whereas other people, they can't handle that. They really can't. Actors have a very difficult time. It gets to them, right? They don't wow it enough. They don't wow it. It's a very, very, very tough thing to do, actually. And they have massive problems because of it. Entertainers have massive problems. After a show, you should spend like an hour or two of just quiet time, meditation. Seriously. Just to wow what had just happened. Because it's a collective thing that just happened. It's us remembering that we're already saved. We're all already saved. So it's very intense responsibility being in the entertainment business. And most just can't handle it at all. They just can't. Which is why I'm not part of the, you know, I'm part of the big entertainment business from the Dharma Kings. I'm part of their entertainment empire business. Vast entertainment empire, the Dharma Kings. It's a great responsibility, actually. It's a very intense responsibility. You have to be, you know, really have to alternate the rabbit and the tortoise and the hare. And so there are times when I'm just, you know, full blast, and then times I got just opposite, total wow, just quiet, wow it all. Just drop it, the whole world, and just wow it. That's the required discipline. If you want to help the Dharma Kings, this is the required discipline. And so they're working with me to bring me along. My singing, I don't want to say too much about it because you don't want to be, you know, get self-conscious and put expectations on yourself. You just don't want to have expectations. But they're working with me on vocalization, I might call it. Vocalization. It's beyond singing, actually. I'm vocalizing. So I do a lot of vocalizing about, you know, 5 days a week. And about 2 days a week now, my voice is great. It just shocks me, the vocalization I'm doing. And I keep going into new territory. Every time, every day, I'd go into new territory. I don't just try to robotically go over what I've already done. I say, let me try this. Just like in exercise, let me try something different. That's the Laird Hamilton school of, you know, exercise is always throw something different at yourself. And in vocalization, because that's the Clarity Ross vocalization way, is you keep doing something different. And I'm able, so far, able to do that. And it's just like I'm driving and I'm just vocalizing and I'm just like shocking myself, wowing myself all day long. Like, yeah, that was cool. Oh, that was great. I'd love to hear that. Well, you know, oh, I expected this riff, but you did that one. That was completely unexpected and it worked great. And it's like that all day. The same thing with taping. I keep wowing myself. I didn't expect you to do that, but you know, did it. And so we can wow ourselves in this way. And it needs to be this 360 of spontaneous, genuine, sublime creativity. Okay, not just cheap thrills. We're not into cheap thrills here. We're really, this vocalization is beautiful. It's just, But I don't do it on camera because that's a performance. You know, what I'm doing, it's totally unselfconscious. Nobody's listening. It's just what I want to hear. I say, let me try this. And it sounds great. So you could do this. You don't need to perform for anyone. All right? You don't really need to perform. Leave the performing to the experts. It's a very specialized, intense discipline, actually, to be able to do that successfully. Very few can do it. Leave that to the ones who have had really, really great specific training. You don't need to perform for anyone except for yourself. Perform for yourself. Da da dum da da dum dum da. So I don't stick with the songs. I start soaring and flying, but it all because the confidence and the voice and the strength, everything is there. It doesn't matter what I do. I can't miss. You know, whatever flight, it's like a bird flying. I mean, do you ever look at a bird and say, "Oh, that's a terrible flight"? No, because whatever flight they do, they, you know, they always can correct it in some way, and it all works out for them. So it's like being a bird. I feel like I'm like a bird, actually. And the birds are actually helping me out tremendously. Fly like a bird. Vocalize like a bird. So I don't even worry about where I'm going. Because I know I can always just slip right back into whatever's I'm listening to. And just keep flowing. I can just keep flowing. I don't freeze up. And then everything sounds great. Oh, well, and then you can take risks. You're not afraid to take this big risk. You know, let me vocalize like this. I don't know what's going to happen. And you do it, and you flow back, and you say, wow, that was a nice flight. So it's kind of like a bird is just trying different, you know, different soaring and different this. The birds are so good at what they do, aren't they? I was watching some birds today. They're just, you know, wow. They're so confident in their flying and everything, the way they come into trees and land and everything they do. They're so expert at it. And we're thinking, like, how do they manage like that? It's amazing, birds, isn't it? They're really quite extraordinary. Land, sea, air, you name it, the birds can handle it with two legs. I don't know how they do it. They're very confident in what they do. Be like a hummingbird in your vocalizations. You're just hovering. You can go any direction, any moment. That's how I feel when I'm vocalizing. I'm not tied into any line at all. Each moment, I feel I can go 360 degrees anywhere with it. Now, that is a cool feeling, believe me. So this feeling is possible for you because I'm having this feeling. It's just you have to dedicate and work at it consistently with courage and daring. To push past the fear of expectations. And if you're not performing for anyone, okay, it's a lot easier. What really stifles us is thinking we need to perform. I don't like that, you know, performing. You feel like, well, okay, what do they want to hear? You know, I don't know. And when you perform, when you're really doing great, people are shocked, they're afraid of it. They say, no, I'm used to hearing this. And it's funny because, like on YouTube, there's all this music you can use for free that's copyright free. And So I can edit. I can use the music and then edit. If you use anything that's copyrighted, you can't edit it. You can use it on YouTube and there's no strikes against you, but you cannot edit it on YouTube. That's a big problem for me. But I work around it. Okay, I understand. I mean, it's very gracious of these musicians to allow their music to be used in such a way. They monetize it, of course, in the number of views, but still, it's very gracious. There's a few groups that don't do it. The Beatles don't do it. The Rolling Stones, as far as I can tell, don't allow it. I looked, it's blocked in all countries, it said. There's a few musicians that musical groups don't allow, and I understand that's fine. I mean, I think musicians should be paid for their work. Absolutely. It's a great talent they have, and they deserve to be paid. So I'm not bothered by that copyright thing. But I just discovered a couple of days ago that you don't get strikes on your channel if you use this music. What are you kidding me? I thought before, you know, you'll get banned from YouTube. Now, no. The most groups allow it. It's just they're banned in certain countries, like Germany. Germany bans anything that's copyrighted. You can't watch a video with anything that's copyrighted in Germany. Well, kudos to them. I mean, they're very strict, I guess, upholding copyright law, which I think is great. I think it's great. But the you know the trends are such that people allow their music to be used. And if they decide they don't want it used, they want it taken down, and they insist on it, then you can get a strike, a copyright strike. So they can YouTube says, well, if they change their mind, you know, then you could be in trouble. You know, that's kind of okay. You take the video down, you know, is a way to you know cure that, I believe, or something. But it's a little nerve wracking using other people's music, and I don't like doing it actually. I like to just have the natural sound effects so nobody's worried about music. I don't feel that comfortable using musicians' music because I feel they should be getting, you know, royalties and getting paid for it. I mean, it's a very tough life. And trends constantly change and then they're out in the cold. You know, I've been through that. It's horrible. It's horrible. Life of a musician. It's just horrible. You're trying to help the world through music and tastes are constantly changing. And when tastes change, believe me, you are done. You are done. Unless you're one of the faves of the baby boomers, you know, you can keep playing, you know, going to the oldies concerts and keep doing that. A lot of them are doing that, playing the same old stuff, and that's it. But in terms of trying to stay current, you're just out of it. And these days, tastes change so quickly, you're out of it in a flash. You know, you might have one hit, and then that's it. And you're this dedicated musician. It's just gruesome, actually, being a musician, just gruesome. Horrible. So I'm saying, hey, you know what? You can have more fun than the musicians are having by just vocalizing. I have more fun. Of course, I have been a longtime musician in previous lives and in this life. I'm, in fact, one of the most dedicated musicians in history, actually. Known for that. Known for being a master of music. Yeah, I was just, you know, totally dedicated to it. Had a massive, one of the greatest music libraries in the world, private libraries in the world, in a previous life. Just, you know, I was 100% music. I wasn't married, no family. It's been at least a couple lifetimes now of no family. I'm married now, but didn't have any, natural children. So, you know, it's not like I didn't really have a family life. It may have been more than one, two lives, three lives. I've been very much a renunciate artist who dedicates their entire life to art. That is my thing. So it's not like I'm just some dilettante here. I mean, I have spent lifetimes of total dedication to being creative and trying to help the world in a creative way. But tastes change and you are out. And you're on the outs, you can't get back in. It's crazy. And even now, social tastes in art are rapidly changing. And the stuff that would have been loved, you know, back in the 80s or whenever, now people are like, oh, what's that? I put up these, I mean, the videos I'm making now, I mean, back in the day, people would have just to die for these, just to die for them. But now it's like, if you can't consume it in 1 second, it's nothing. You know, you got to consume it in like 1 second, because it's everybody is Facebooking on the go. You know, let me look at this, look at this. Okay, oh, I've got to do something else. Let me look at this. Okay, I've got to do something else. And so they don't allow themselves to be immersed in it enough to feel the wow of it. They dissipate. It's avoidance. But that's what they're doing. And so you have to have these quick hitters. And I could do that, but I don't quite seem to, you know, my spirit is such that it pulls you into something deeper, and they don't want that. They just want it to be superficial and quick. Junk food. Everybody's on trying to make enough money to survive, and they don't have time to sit down to a two-hour meal, right? It's junk food. So they're engaging in spiritual junk food. It looks good on the surface, right? It's like a happy meal. But, you know, before too long, you start having, you know, all these ulcers and indigestion and all these diseases, right? Yeah. So I'm telling you, it's spiritual junk food. It's okay as a stage, but you got to push beyond it. And people of my generation, we grew up on way more dedication, capacity to, for our attention spans are really fabulous in comparison to now. Totally fabulous. And, you know, so I'm trying to make the video shorter, 6 minutes. Even that's too much of people. They want 1 second or 6 seconds. Facebook says, don't put too many words on there. People don't like that. You know, make just like one line. Picture and one line. This is the guidelines. Facebook has these guidelines of what they want from you, and they actually steer you in that way. They flag photos that have too much text on it, and they're pushing you into this, you know, 6 second life. The 6 second life, actually, it's true. Like. Right? And no one has time for anything. Like, I see. Oh, like that. Okay, like that. For me, I see a picture. I want to just sit there and wow it. And so what I do, I comment. See, when you comment, you have to think about, what am I going to say? So I might spend like 5 minutes with a picture and go back to it. And if there's dialogue in the comments, then you stay with the picture and you see it again and again and again. This is just spiritual training. Okay, this is what's helpful. Is the more time you spend with it, the more helpful it becomes for you. And looking at these videos that I make over and over again, I'm seeing them, I see more and more and more and more and more, and I say, wow, that's so profound, because you're giving a lot to it. So these songs that I vocalize with, I've vocalized with them thousands and thousands of times. It's like an old friend, and it feels better now than ever, actually. So it's a familiar base from which to take flights of great creative fancy, right? The bird knows what this nest, and it'll come back to the nest, and then it can go out and soar the wind and ball go over, and then comes back to the nest. It's like that. But these days, like, there's no nest for anyone. It's just extraordinary what's happening. It's very robotic. Robotics are programmed, you know, to this, and do it fast. But it's the same motion, do, you know. What's that? It's hell, is what it is, actually. You're being programmed for hell. We're being programmed for hell right now. So, we have an election coming up. Okay, I haven't said anything about it. One of the reasons I'm not taping, I'm staying away from that. I'm not posting. I made a promise. No, I'm not going to post anything on Facebook about the election. No gender issues, no election issues, all this stuff. People don't want to hear it, okay? They can't handle it. They have no attention span. They just want junk sugar. You know, junk food, nice junk food, you know, like organic junk food, basically, is what they want. So that's fine. That's good. I give them a lot of that, too. They like that, and I like what they do. I like the posting of everybody on Facebook. It's very nice. It's very helpful at a certain level, which is fine. But what I'm saying is you need to go to deeper level, okay? You have to be more committed. As Muji, I think Muji had this quote. Muji's very humorous. Of course I like Muji. I love Muji. For like 3 years, I spent, I think, 2 or 3 years just listening to Muji. So I was very into Muji. And he that was a wonderful phase. Okay. There's life beyond Muji. There's a spiritual path beyond Muji. Okay. But I got a lot from him. So thank you, Muji. Namaskar and pranam for your help, you know. He gave me the spirit that you can be humorous and you can have a personality and you can use words and you can be in the world, you can do all of this and you can tape and put it on YouTube. I really started doing my lot of taping, spiritual taping, because I felt like Muji was a pioneer. Okay, Muji is a pioneer. He pioneered it. So all praise to the pioneers. Absolutely. But again, is there a spiritual path after Muji? Yes. Is there a spiritual path after these various gurus in the world? Yes, there is. In fact, we're actually greater than the gurus. Okay, gurus are just a clear shadow of what we really are. Okay, all this here is a shadow play in the world. Gurus are a shadow play too, but they're a clear shadow. It's like, whoa, there's a shadow, but it's clear. You know, it's like, wow, that's amazing. Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma was like a perfectly clear shadow. And it's like, I feel like, what is this? Some say she cast no shadow when she was walking around. I don't know if that's true or not. That's possible. I haven't checked her pictures out to see if that's true. But certainly in some of her videos, you might be able to see if that's true or not, that she didn't cast any shadow. But I imagine that I don't know. But metaphorically, spiritually, she has a clear shadow. But we are greater than all shadows. We are the actual source of eternal life, okay? Because we're the Son of God. And, of course, but our source is God, okay? So we didn't create ourselves. We can extend eternal life, but the capacity to do that came from God, not from ourselves, okay? There's a difference between us and God is that. The direction of creation goes in one direction from the prime creator flowing through us, the Son of God. That's it. We can't reverse that direction, and we're trying to, and we can't do it, and this has caused us this shadow play, you might call it. So we're greater than the gurus, and so the best gurus are the ones that empower us this way, that say, you're greater than me, in terms of I'm just an appearance, a shadow play, but you're, okay, don't stop at the guru. So like Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, who's as great of a guru as we'll ever see in this world, or anywhere in the universe, she came to empower us. It was never about her. It was never about her. This is the extraordinary thing about her. It's never about her. And this is a difference between her and some of the gurus in the world of today. You know, they're helpful. But, I mean, nobody, it's pretty tough to be like her. Ram Maharshi was too. Same. They were the same level. Okay. She had the action thing going for her. He had the silence thing going. She had that going too, but he was, you know, very much the ascetic. He had the ascetic silence. But, you know, they're very like much in this same equivalent, you know, echelon of the highest echelon of gurus. And so she came to visit us. And it was always about us. It was always about us. And She would tell us, you know, you are God. You're greater than any appearance, including the appearance of the guru. It's not about me. It's about you. I'm already aware of all this, of the oneness. So now it's about you accepting this fact that you are life itself. And so she came as like a lowly servant of us, a lowly servant. And it was never about her picture. She never put herself at the center of anything. Wherever she went, she would be on the side. No, I'm just here in support of you. I'm, you know, and then she'd leave. It was never about her being this big, you know, guru at all. Never. She was not attached to her guru role in the slightest bit. She had no spiritual ego whatsoever. That's why I say she's the greatest guru you're ever going to find. As great. There's no one that you'll ever find that surpasses Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma. So it's tough having a guru about that. We like gurus that it's all about them. That protects us. That's continuity fear. We're looking, no, it's not about me. It's about you. You're the great guru. You're the one who's realized, not me. But Sri Sri and I might say, no, it's about you. It's about you. I'm here out of love for you and your path and your success. And I'm putting you center stage. Okay? You're center stage in my life. So she said, don't see me as the mother. See me as a little girl, your friend, a sister, but not as this mother guru figure. She didn't like that. She said, that's not why I'm here. But you know, a lot of devotees still insist upon it. I go along with it because that's a phase too. Okay, so like on Facebook, there's a lot of, most of my friends are devotees of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, which is great. But they insist on seeing her as mother and all this, and which is a stage. It's a stage. So I'm not really at that stage, but I understand it, so I go along with it. That's fine. Jema, you know, Jema. I feel that too. That's okay. But she said it's better, it's preferable. It's a higher stage to see her as your friend, and that she's here in support of you. It's not about her. She's just here in support of you. It's about you. Your path is about you. Your life itself. You're greater than any appearance of any guru that's ever appeared anywhere. You're greater than that. Absolutely, we all are. We all are greater than the gurus, and yet the gurus come to remind us of that fact. So all praise to the gurus. So I have various Facebook friends because the Holy Spirit says, just allow it. And you know, I can easily see what's going on in the world by different Facebook friends. So if someone sends a friend request, I just always say yes. Now, I used to be more picky, but I said, I can learn from everybody. And they show me, you know, the mistakes they're making, and it's very obvious and evident to me where they're at. And it's fine. It's fine. And some are very advanced, actually. And others are, you know, earlier, you know, more basic stages, and hoping, you know, for this and that, and hoping that it all, you know, duality works out for them, and still have a lot of continuity fear. I look at it as stages of continuity fear. This is how I look at it. It simplifies everything. Totally simplifies everything, and it's actually accurate. So I don't worry. What spiritual phase are you in? No, it's just, you know, how much continuity fear do you have left, and where are you at in evaporating it? I'm able to see it all very clearly in this way. Vastly simpler approach. That's why I say, as soon as you recognize continuity fear, you are on the high path, just like that, really high path. Very few have recognized this. Immediately, you recognize that you're on the high path, just like that. Because it all suddenly simplifies, and you say, oh my gosh, it's so simple, isn't it? It's all just continuity fear. It's the only problem anyone has. Nobody has any other problem whatsoever. None. Zero. Nobody has any problem whatsoever except continuity fear. That's the cause of all our suffering, everything. It's just that. So take the edge off of your continuity fear, and you will feel yourself to be really exceptional. Really exceptional. And it's true. You will be. As soon as you recognize continuity fear, you're on an the exception. You're such an exception to what's going on in the world, right? Because you realize everyone's already saved, whereas they keep thinking, no, we're on a path to salvation. We need to do all this stuff to be saved. And that's not true at all. There's nothing we need to do to be saved. Everyone's already saved, and you know this is tough for people to realize. A lot of my Christian brothers have. See, no, a lot of people are going to be damned and forever, and God's going to annihilate them. And so, you know, they don't see it the way I see it. But, you know, I understand where they're at. They have a lot of continuity fear still left, but they're working on it. And some, you know, are making a lot of progress. There's some friends on Facebook who are really tremendous. They really are tremendous. They're really getting there. They really are. They're really going towards realization that nothing needs to be done. And all I have to do is help, you know, broadcast that to the world. Let everyone know this is true. And they'll get there. You know, they're moving at their own pace, and that's fine. I'm moving at my pace, and it's pretty doggone fast right now. If you're in my shoes, you might just jump right out of my shoes, actually. It's like a whirlwind of activity and just boom, 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 boom. But 360 degrees, it's not robotic, hydraulic robotic activity. It's spontaneous activity in the now of just, okay, this can be, okay, I'm going to do this. So right now I'm probably going to say, okay, that's enough taping, right? 114. Yeah, okay, another there. There's the, okay. It's probably going to, then I will stop it. I feel like I need to stop. It's going to be the 114. 414, right? There you go, Jibby.